Everybody, welcome back to another week of Powerhouse Kids Live. I am so happy to see you here. And today we're going to continue our series talking about how we can be creative and how God, our creator, is creative. So creativity is imagining what you could do because you're made in God's image. So one thing that we can do to be super duper creative is worship God. So right now, I want you guys to stand up with me, and let's just worship our Creator.
You spoke one word, and the dark became light. I believe it, yeah. You spoke my name, and my heart came to life. I believe it, yeah. I wanna sing about it. I wanna scream and shout it. I'm gonna sing it right now. At the top of my lungs I sing. With all of my heart I will praise you. God, you are everything. You're the reason that I lift my voice. At the top of my lungs I sing. By my side. I believe it, yeah. I wanna sing about it. I wanna scream and shout it.
Awesome job, everybody. So before we continue in worship, let's watch this video. All right, anyways, so one of my favorite verses in the Bible is 1 Peter 2:9, and it says, God chose you to be his people. You are royal priests. You are a holy nation. You are God's special treasure. You are all these things so that you can give him praise. God brought you out of the darkness and into his wonderful life. So that verse basically says that we were created to give God praise. So that's what we're going to do right now before we watch our video.
I stand before you now. The greatness of your renown. I've heard of the majesty and wonder of you, King of heaven. In humility I bow as your love in wave after wave crashes over.
Today, I'm here to talk to you about creativity. Creativity is imagining what you could do because you were made in God's image. There are so many different artistic ways to be creative. And today, I hope to demonstrate just how creative I am in the culinary arts. Now, you might be thinking, oh, hey, Jacob, what are the culinary arts? And that's totally okay because I had to look it up too. I had no idea. So allow me to elucidate. I had to look that word up too. Okay. Basically, it's this. I'm making chocolate.
Yes.
You see, I started thinking. I know I'm creative because I was created in the image of God. But what if drawing and sculpting and, you know, art stuff isn't my thing. What if chocolate making was my thing? my purpose. And time for the last thing, the cocoa powder. In my research, I learned that chocolate comes from a bean that grows from the cacao tree, which technically means that chocolate's a vegetable. True story. Oh, this looks so good. Bon appetit. That is so good. I think I've really discovered what my purpose is. Chocolatey goodness. It's like in today's story. God had a purpose for a woman named Esther, and you're going to find out if she discovered her purpose before it was too late. Time to check the old recipe book. Oh, let's see. Chill for 4 hours. Chill for 4 hours. No, I'm kidding, obviously. It means to put it in the freezer.
Just,
duh. I had to look it up. And I spent 2 hours in the freezer before it realized that it meant the chocolate and not me. So, see you soon.
So, when you are a kid, which I'm assuming most of you are, there's one question that adults always tend to ask you. And that question is, what do you want to be when you grow up? It's a pretty scary question. And I think it's funny how kids get asked that all the time, because the truth is, no one really knows exactly what God has for us in the future. We tend to forget that God can use us in amazing ways, no matter what we grow up to be. So, speaking of how God uses us in big ways, today we are talking about Esther. And the cool thing about Esther is she is one of the many women in the Bible who have amazing stories, and God used them in amazing ways. So boys weren't the only people that God used in the Bible. And Esther is an example of that. So today, I'm asking my media team to help me out here, and we're going to tell the story of Esther with some really, really cool sound effects. Hopefully. Fingers crossed. So, Esther's story is a great example of how God can work through us in unexpected ways. And we find Esther's story in the Old Testament. So Esther lived about 400 years before Jesus was born. And Esther was the queen of Persia. Perfect. But she didn't become queen in the usual way. In fact, I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit. Let's back up and go to the beginning of Esther's life before she was queen. Now, the thing about Esther is she didn't become queen in the usual way. Her father wasn't a king. He was not a king. And neither was her mom. Her mom wasn't a queen either. And Esther's family wasn't really considered important at all in the kingdom. Esther was Jewish. Her family was among the Jewish people who had been captured and taken to Babylon, which was then captured by Persia, which is the kingdom we're in right now. So sadly, Esther's parents died when she was young, so she was raised by her cousin, Mordecai. And Mordecai was also Jewish. So both Esther and Mordecai were of Jewish descent. So Esther's story wasn't really off to a great start. Her family was captured, her parents died, and then she was raised by her cousin in a land that was not her home. But Mordecai really took Esther in as his own daughter. So we can imagine how he taught her the ancient scriptures and the ways of the Jewish people, because Mordecai was really, really passionate about his faith. So during this time, a man named Xerxes, his name starts with an X, so that's how I'm going to pronounce it. Hope y'all don't mind. But he came to power as the king of Persia. Now, Xerxes was very, very powerful, but he had one downfall. He had a very, very big temper, and one day he got angry. And so he decided to fire his queen, Vashti. And the only reason he fired her was because she didn't show up for this wild party. So Xerxes decided to hold a contest to find a new queen. So you heard me right, a contest. The king ordered his officials to gather the most beautiful young women in the land and put them through an entire year of beauty treatments just for this contest, an entire year. It's crazy. So Esther was one of the girls they chose because she was so beautiful. And guess what? Esther won the stinking contest. You heard that right. Xerxes chose Esther as his queen. How cool is that? I mean, a girl can dream, right? Anyways, Mordecai told Esther. He advised her not to tell anyone about her Jewish heritage. So she headed off to live in the palace with no one there knowing that she was a Jew. So Esther wasn't the only new person that Xerxes brought in. He also promoted one of his royal officials, and that was a man named Haman, to be his second in command. So Haman was not a really nice guy, sadly. He's kind of the bad guy in our story. He was kind of like the playground bully with the power of the adult in charge. Not a good combination, might I add. In fact, he ordered everyone to bow down to him. So everyone did as they were told, except for Esther's cousin, Mordecai. So when Haman found out that Mordecai refused to bow to him, he became super duper angry. So Haman was so angry that he planned on not only destroying Mordecai, but all of the Jewish people in the kingdom. So he took the plan to King Xerxes, who agreed to it and sent out a decree. So just like that, messengers took a letter all over the kingdom to declare the news from the king. And so what was this news, you ask? On the 13th day of the 12th month, all of the Jewish people were to be killed. That's a little drastic, don't you think? Like, that's pretty crazy. So when Mordecai and the others discovered this horrible news that they were doomed to be killed, they were obviously very upset, right? I mean, I would be too. So Mordecai sent a message to Esther in the palace, because that's where she was. Esther was the new queen, so she was living it up in the palace while her relatives and friends were given this death sentence. So that's the context. And so Mordecai told her in a letter that she needed to ask King Xerxes to save their people. So Esther was very upset hearing this news. And she also was upset because she knew that if she went to the king and asked for help, she'd be risking her own life. So kingdoms back then were a little different than your normal fairy tale. Esther couldn't just walk up to the king and make this request. She had to be put through a whole process in order to make her request known to the king. So Esther was upset to hear this news. And she wrote Mordecai a letter and reminded him that no one was allowed to approach the king. So the only way that people were allowed to approach the king was if the king asked them to come. And if Esther went to the king, she might die, unless he reached out his golden scepter to her. So if you don't know what a scepter is, a scepter was this like really cool staff, normally golden, that showed the power of the king. But Mordecai knew that there was a reason that Esther had been made queen. So let's read what he wrote her in a letter in the book of Esther. And in Esther 4, verse 14, it says, "What if you don't say anything at this time? Then help for the Jews will come from another place. Who knows? It's possible that you became queen for just a time like this." So Esther knew that Mordecai was right. And she told him to gather all the Jewish people and to fast for 3 days. So fasting, normally in the biblical context, means the people went without eating food, maybe certain food, or no food altogether, and focused on praying and petitioning God to save them. So the people spent 3 days fasting and in prayer. So Esther and her attendants did the same thing. And Esther was preparing herself for what she was about to do, and that was risk her life and approach the king. So 3 days later, Esther put on her royal robes, and she entered the throne room. Would King Xerxes be pleased to see her? So the king... Thank you. That's enough. So, good news. King Xerxes was pleased to see Esther, and he reached out his golden scepter to her. So, the king said he would give her anything, up to half the whole kingdom. But Esther knew that she couldn't make her request to save the Jews right away. She knew that she would have a better chance of success if she made the king curious as to what her request would be. So she invited Xerxes and Haman to a feast. And at the meal, Xerxes again tried to discover what Esther was going to ask him. So Esther held her ground, and she waited for the perfect moment. So she invited Haman and the king to come to another feast the next day. And she told him that then she would give him her answer. So finally, at the meal, Esther told the king about Haman's evil decree. It was going to kill all of her relatives and even her. So she asked the king to spare her people. And Xerxes was angry. He wasn't angry with Esther, as you might think. He asked, who would dare to do such a thing? And Esther told him that it was Haman, his second in command. So the king, burned with anger, and that very night, Haman was killed. And King Xerxes created a new decree that would save the Jewish people. Yay! So thank you to the media team for helping me tell the story of Esther in a super creative way. I had a great time. Hope you guys were really involved and loved those sound effects. So, wrapping it up, God gave Esther a surprising position in a faraway nation. And when the time was right, she used all that God gave her to make a huge difference. She used her creativity to save her people. So God gave us special gifts too. And he has a plan for your life that you'll be able to discover more and more as you get older. So just like Esther was created for a very important job, God created you for a purpose too. So I, for one, cannot wait to see what he has planned for my life and for your life. So let's pray and ask God to help us have some direction and to thank him for giving us a purpose. Dear God, thank you so much for the story of Esther. It is incredible to see how you can use people who are willing to go where you send them and to do your will. We thank you for the promise of Jesus and him coming to save us from our sins. And we just ask that you would help us to see and have discernment on whatever path you want us to go on. I believe that you can use us in amazing ways, so I pray that you would help us to stay on the path that you have planned for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
God always has a purpose. He had a purpose for Queen Esther when he put her in the right place at the right time to save her people. He had a purpose when he sent Jesus to pay for the sins of the world. And here's something you may not know. God made you for a purpose. It's true. Now, you may not have to save a bunch of people from total destruction. I don't know, or Maybe you will. Who knows what God has planned for you? But I do know God has a plan and a purpose for your life, whether it be big or small. So think about it. What's your purpose? Is there something you like to do more than anything else? Like baking, or organizing, or juggling. Maybe what you like to do has something to do with your purpose. Or what about this? Is there something that you care about more than anything else? Like animals, or taking care of people, or keeping the planet clean? Maybe those things have something to do with your purpose. Whatever it is, here's the one thing to remember. God created you for a purpose. Actually, I think it would be safe to say purposes. Maybe it's something giant, like Esther. Or maybe something simple, like chocolates. Didn't get it. So close, gonna keep trying. Yes! Purpose!
So God had a big purpose in mind for Esther. And so let's read back what Mordecai wrote in that letter to her. In Esther 4:14, it's possible that you became queen for a time just like this. So God had the most amazing purpose and plan when he sent his son Jesus. He sent Jesus to save the world, just like Esther was sent to save the Jewish people. So before Jesus came to be our Savior, because Jesus came to be our Savior, we can have a relationship with God that will last forever. So our bottom line for today is God created you for a purpose. So I want you to say that with me right now. God created you for a purpose. All right, so you might wonder exactly what your purpose is. Sometimes it's something big and exciting that God does through you over a period of years, or other times it's just like the small day-to-day things, and you choose to use the gifts that God has given you. A lot of times, it's a mixture of both. So I want you to pay attention to the gifts that God gave you. And when you get a chance to use them, do it. Jump at that chance. You can also think about the things that excite you, or the things that make you sad, or things that make you compassionate or passionate. Maybe you have the skills and ideas to help solve problems that you can't even see yet. There are so many ways that we can live out God's purpose for our life. So I want to thank you guys for joining me again for another week of Powerhouse Live. Hope you all have a great week, and be creative. Whoa, whoa, whoa.